If we possessed a time machine, and if we could go back nearly 2,000 years ago, and if we could understand ancient Aramaic, the language Jesus used, I wonder if we would still even be able to pick Jesus out of the crowd. The images of Jesus that we know today, that are so popular in our mass religious culture, are usually wishy-washy, even misleading. You know the images I mean, that surly, sentimental, tangy, domesticated Jesus, with perfect, almost a pink complexion, and with wavy, perfectly groomed hair. This is a Jesus that only gives lots and lots of comfort, and who makes hardly any demands. This is an entirely inoffensive Jesus that everybody likes. If this really were Jesus, it's hard to imagine why anyone would have opposed him, much less nailed him to a cross. But this Jesus whom we have constructed according to our own preferences is decidedly not the Jesus revealed in the Gospels. The real Jesus was certainly loving and merciful, but he also managed to offend just about everyone. He upset many established notions of religious propriety. First of all, he spoke of God in terms of such personal familiarity and close intimacy. To some people, his preaching sounded like blasphemy. He welcomed the kind of questionable company that most devout people avoided. He provoked nearly all the leaders of his day, both civil and religious, and he was steadfast in the kind of activity that predictably led to his arrest and execution. And although many of the common people at first were glad to hear him, many later became disillusioned when he turned out to be a very different kind of Messiah than the one they were expecting. They had hoped for a new King David who would defeat the Romans in battle and also keep their bellies full. But the real Jesus came to defeat much greater and much more terrible enemies, such as Satan, sin, and even death itself. The real Jesus came not to just feed them with fish and bread that only satisfies for a moment, but the real Jesus wanted to feed them with bread from heaven that would sustain them for eternity. The real Jesus preached a word that could be difficult, even irritating. He had some hard sayings that seemed to ask more of ordinary human beings than most of us would prefer. And the real Jesus never apologized for the startling personal choices he demanded. The real Jesus did not just preach mercy. The real Jesus also preached about the day of judgment and about punishment for those who refuse to change their lives. The real Jesus could be hard to take. And the real Jesus, clearly, is a take-it-or-leave-it person. You either accept him or you reject him. Today's gospel, according to Matthew, offers us an example of how Jesus didn't always speak the way Jewish areas of the Holy Land. They were basically hiding out along the coast in the mostly pagan area of Tyre and Sidon. Today's Gospel, according to Matthew, Jesus encounters a Canaanite woman. Now, even though she was a Gentile, she starts screeching and hollering after Jesus and his companions because her daughter was troubled by a demon. Please remember that for reasons of ritual purity, observant Jewish men avoided most contact with anyone outside their own families, and certainly would never have anything to do with an unclean pagan woman. So Jesus, not at all the way we might expect, at first refuses even the answer. The disciples as well were irritated, offended by her inconvenient presence. They begged the Lord, just get rid of her. Then Jesus, in a manner we would never expect, seems to agree with their prejudice and disdain. And he declares that he didn't come to save Gentiles. Instead, he had been sent, first of all, to save the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But that Gentile woman refuses to be put off. She pleads with Jesus to save her daughter. Then Jesus answers with words that are harsh and even sound cruel. He says, it is not right to take food reserved for one's children, namely for the Jews, and throw it out the ground for the dogs, namely for Gentiles. Now, we've heard this gospel every year, and I don't know if we listen to it that clearly. We tend to think of the Savior as never saying things that are shocking. And we have to remember, his words wouldn't have been as shocking then. Jews generally regarded all Gentiles as dogs. That's because dogs do not discriminate between clean and unclean food, as observant Jews always did when they ate. But that Gentile woman would not be put off merely by degrading words about her unclean status. She simply refused to stop screaming for help and demanding a miracle. This encounter with a pagan woman is the one and only example in the entire New Testament when the Lord Jesus is actually beaten in any kind of debate. The woman boldly argues that even the dogs eat the scraps that may fall from their master's table. And then Jesus, speaking to that Gentile woman, and really speaking to all of us who are also Gentiles and have no inherent claim on the mercy of the God of Israel, he declares, "Woman, you have great faith, and what you ask for will happen." And her little girl was delivered. All the blessings once promised only to the chosen people of Israel would now be extended even to the pagan Gentiles. The prophecy of Isaiah that we heard in today's first reading had once predicted, foreigners will join themselves to the Lord, ministering to him and loving the name of the Lord. And this universal way to salvation, this way to healing, this way to God could only come from the kind of fearless faith in the Lord Jesus Christ that will not take no for an answer. Jesus read in the heart of that unclean pagan a surprising, amazing trust in him that was deeper and even more persistent than what he found among his own people. This kind of stubborn, relentless, insistent faith finally could scriptures clearly testify that the Lord, like an inspired teacher, like a gifted coach, or like a commanding general, often surprised his followers and stretched their expectations. He expanded their comfort zone and made unexpected demands. Even the Lord's closest disciples often found them hard to take. The words of Jesus are often difficult to accept because they so often run counter to those very aspects of our human nature that Jesus came into this world to entirely change. There's nothing new about greed or lust, about laziness or selfishness. There's nothing new about being a bully or preferring selfish pleasure rather than embracing personal responsibility. There's certainly, sadly, nothing new about wars and rumors of wars. And there is certainly nothing new about being religious only when it's easy, honoring fabricated religious idols rather than reverencing the jealous love and terrible holiness of the living and one true God. Jesus knows our hearts. Jesus always teaches us the truth. And what was true 2,000 years ago is just as true today. There is such a thing as right and wrong. There is such a thing as God's judgment. There is a real choice between an eternity in heaven or an eternity in hell. St. John Paul II, whose holy relics today are venerated in our cathedral, clearly taught that truth. He taught that what was true was an objective reality and not merely some personal preference, and that all of us would one day be judged on the basis of our obedience to the truth given to us by God, the truth that gives us new life, the truth that really sets us free. Jesus himself once observed that many are called, but few are chosen. But those who have ears to hear, really hear. So like that Canaanite who taught so many centuries ago, we must first of all recognize our own great need. And then when we come to the real Jesus of the Holy Gospels, let nothing stop us from hearing him, crying out to him, surrendering our hearts to his heart, giving over our lives to him, and believing him both when it's easy and when it's hard. As our precious Catholic faith boldly proclaims, the real Jesus is truly present in our midst in the most holy Eucharist that we are about to receive. So this very evening, at this Mass, when we come to Holy Communion, the Lord may have some surprising and life-changing words to say to the hearts of each one of us. May we all listen and obey. May we worship and adore, and so be converted. May the grace of God replace the sadness of sin. May we prefer nothing to Jesus, who preferred nothing to us. And then assuredly, like that Gentile woman in today's gospel, our faith